Thanks, Mark. Mark said nearly everything I was going to say. So as Mark said, not that long ago we finished a master's at RMIT, and one of the things that came out of the master's was an observation to do with our work, which was a small phrase, which is specificity that surprises, and it's a kind of a bit of a mouthful, but this was used to describe by some of the people at RMIT, a phrase used to describe the way that we go about finding ideas in the architectural process. And the phrase is originally attributed to the English literary critic I.A. Richards, who said, I'm told, that what is sought in any creative work is a kind of specificity that surprises, because if you don't have that, all you summon up in an audience is a kind of a stop response or boredom. And he then goes on to cite a poem by D.H. Lawrence called The Piano, and in this particular poem, the reader is put in a position of thinking that they're beneath the ceiling of a massive building, from the ceiling emanates these huge booming sounds. And then quite quickly, within a number of short passages, it becomes apparent that this is not what it seems at all, but this is the memory of being a small child playing underneath a grand piano. And so there's this wonderful kind of literary moment where the reader is transported in time and space, in a way, from the time of adulthood back to childhood and back to adulthood, and in spatial terms, from the space of the real space of the reader to the mind space of the reader, from the space of a giant unusual building to the small space of a piano, and then all the way back out again. And I think it's pretty obvious that this has got really interesting sort of architectural implications in many ways. And I guess since having thought of our work in these terms through the research and other studies we did during the Masters, we've been able to focus in on ways that specificity and more particularly surprise influence our work. And whilst specificity is very important, I think, in terms of, Mark mentioned it earlier, in terms of focusing in at a very unusually detailed level as to what projects might want to be, for us it's actually all about the surprise. And more, I think we try to find that. And Mark also used the term idiosyncrasy, and I think it's really important, even as students, to understand the role of idiosyncrasy. And it's a kind of a two-way street in some ways. What we try to do is, in the first instance, be completely deferential to a project, completely submit ourselves to a project, and try to understand, in a deep kind of sense, what the idiosyncrasies of a project are, and then once that's established, use our own idiosyncrasies as an overlay to that. You can't evade your own idiosyncrasies, but I think at least if you understand the relationship between your own idiosyncrasies and the idiosyncrasies of things around you, you can end up, in a way, more consciously using your own idiosyncrasies, such that once the project is finished, it returns back to being the project that belongs in a particular place at a particular time. So what I wanted to do today, because I've never been here before, is go through quite a number of projects, as many as we can within the short period of time that we have. And I just wanted to demonstrate this way of thinking more than anything else. And then when we get to the end, we can go back a little deeper into any project that anyone really wants to know about. I guess one of the things we really try and do in our work is find loaded diagrams. Like, this is a fantastic image and provokes a lot of thought, and as soon as you see this image, I think a whole lot of questions pop up, like what's he going to do with the table when he gets wherever he's going? Is he going to turn it back into a table, and maybe he'll turn the outboard motor upside down and use it as some sort of kitchen device? But I think more than anything, this image to us talks about not letting objects be bound by their own physicality. So this guy, obviously, he's got an entirely different reading of a table, and that liberates things from their own physicality. And I think one of the things that we're conscious of in our work is subjugating the physicality of things to enable experiential outcomes to occur, but kind of paradoxically, to have a complete preoccupation with the non-physical, you almost need to have an equal preoccupation with physical things. So this little project is a very old project that we did for the University of Queensland, And we had to take this existing tiered lecture theatre and turn it, gut it and turn it into a flat-floored multifunction seminar room. We had to take out the desks and the seats, take down the old blue curtains and put up new blue curtains, take down the old fluoro lights, put up new fluoro lights, and so on and so on. And there's something pretty interesting about this space. It's one of those kind of fit-outs that is not quite of heritage standing, but is still interesting enough to have something, and this was all headed for the tip. So when we got the project, we started questioning the brief, I think, more than anything else. And there was a moment in the project where we realised that the size and proportion of the desks was exactly the same size and proportion as the window. So you can see on the left the desk as a desk, and on the right the desk used as a curtain or a shutter. So we actually removed all of the desks and put them on rollers and used them as blackout curtains or shutters in the space. And that one sort of specific observation set about a sort of a chain reaction. So then we used the seats as acoustic absorption panels on the ceiling, and then we used the tiered flooring to make the new desks in the space. So you can see the flooring as desks and the shutters in their closed position and the shutters in their open position. And these shutters or desks have this vague familiarity in their vertical orientation, and quite fantastically, these decades and decades of graffiti become apparent as the light glances across the face. And you might be able to read here, question everything, which is a really fitting kind of end to this project, and some smart ass has scratched underneath that why. And it's kind of like a bit of a brain teaser, but this simultaneous sort of compliance and defiance is something, as architects, I think we all come up against from time to time. And I guess this project was a real sort of test case for us many, many years ago about what we value and valuing things that otherwise sometimes fall between the cracks. This is another quite old project that some of you might have seen for the University of Queensland again on one of their rural campuses, and we're presented with this quite institutional and dreary scene at the back of the campus, quite different to the other side of the campus where these prosaic brick buildings have quite sculptural counterpoints to balance things up. But out the back, that's not the case. So we started thinking about the use of brickwork, and I guess bricks in isolation have received quite a stigma in recent years. I guess bricks are to brick veneer what brick veneer is to urban sprawl, and so there's a kind of a some kind of an issue in terms of how we handle this as a building material. We had this kind of idea about how it would be to build a building that really opened up a brick, literally and metaphorically, to new possibilities and enabled a rereading not only of a brick and brick veneer, but also of this little precinct where these prosaic brick buildings might have a new sort of central, wonderfully rich building that enabled the whole precinct to kind of lift itself. At the same time, we were working with a fellow by the name of Ashley Payne, who had developed a series of self-portraits. And these are not figurative self-portraits, but rather they're sort of line markings that are indelibly his own. And he would put those line markings through a series of contemporary processes like chemical baths and pixelation processes and so on to have a look at the effect of various technologies on his own original workings. And what we decided to do is use this as the basis for how we might treat this new brick building. So take these artworks and run them through the brickworking tradition. So a series of very careful drawings were done where we developed a way of bolster cutting bricks with a hand hammered and bolster cut. We developed this using two bricks and a couple of different brick types. So you can see centre split bricks. You see the brick type 1 and brick type 2 with a large core on brick type 1 and 10 small holes in brick type 2. And when you cut them in different ways, you end up with this ability to have subtly different colours and subtly different textures as well. And here's the first lot of bricklayers looking quite perplexed about how to go about this. But as the first few courses went up, we started sort of understanding. We ended up with three bricklayers were involved to make this. And the bricklayer who ended up doing the vast majority of the project came out of retirement, took a great interest in in making the project what it is. The other thing about this project was the interior of it is a laboratory, and it's was a way of managing sort of two client halves. The interior of this is a physically contained, kind of contaminated laboratory environment, so it's all dictated by codes and standards, and it's a very controlled environment, whereas the outside is this fuzzy kind of part of the real world. This is the project Mark mentioned earlier, which is Brisbane Girls Grammar School. Sorry, these slides are now having a habit of changing all by themselves. I'll just see if I can go back a couple. So the foundation building is the yellow building that you see at the top of the screen there, and it forms this very strong axis of symmetry on the site. And what we wanted to do in the formation of this new building is not perpetuate a formal version of symmetry, but to use the axis of symmetry as this choreographed passage through the front of the site, out the back door of the main building, and through that we developed this, I guess, three-dimensional building envelope for the new building. One of the main sort of overarching ideas for this project was, because it was a centre for the arts, was to make connections, just a very broad idea about making connections between various things, connections between various disciplines within the building, as well as connections between the building and the rest of the school, as well as the school and the broader community. And so we simply then went about trying to understand how we might be able to make that happen. So you can see in this image, this is actually an aerial photo of the actual outcome. So you can see the axis of symmetry that comes through from the main building, penetrating deeply into the main space. And the structure of this building is to the west toward the green space is all of the structured learning spaces, and to the east, to the closer side of the image, all of the informal learning spaces. The west edge is rectilinear and spatially simple, and the east edge is non-rectilinear and spatially incredibly complex, and it was pedagogically geared to enable these two kinds of learning to play off one another. I just included some of these images because we don't work in any particular medium. We do lots and lots of writing, we do lots and lots of drawings, we make card models, we do work digitally, a lot of 3D parametric modelling and so on. So we don't have any one particular way of working. And in this particular project, card modelling was really important because you can imagine explaining a building of this degree of spatial complexity to a board of trustees type client. So these models were all able to be pulled apart, back together again, spun around, and so on and so on, which is something that's impossible to do. I've been intrigued to see how many ArchiCAD files have been opened in front of me today and the difficulty of actually kind of working with them. And I think sometimes these kind of simple card models and simple drawings are much more communicable to other people, and certainly in a building of this complexity, it was really, really necessary. So I guess what we really wanted to do in this project on the side of the building that's coming into view now is end up with a really, really social and sociable kind of space. And so what we did was, that's just indicating that alignment that enables this view through to the north, to the distant landscape of Victoria Park. This is a mashup of an Escher drawing and a real photo of our interior space. And what we really wanted to do is trace paths of common travel as well as likely socialisation patterns and end up with this network of staircases and balconies that would A, keep people out of lifts, and B, make this a hive of activity, almost like an ant colony or a Hogwarts type outcome. And apologise for the Hall & Oates. Those are probably a little bit young for Hall & Oates, but this is a... for their 135th anniversary, the students were able to make a DVD of whatever they wanted to, and this is a little snippet from it. And I guess what we're interested in is, when you set up buildings that have certain social potentials, you really don't know what it's going to eventuate. But I think these sorts of outcomes, I guess, I would never have imagined this, but you certainly imagine scenarios like this. So this is a six-story high social space, and you can see up and down through the space from drama to music, from the main sort of cafeteria gallery all the way up to the top floor and down again. And Mark's been there once and was sort of astonished that his daughter spotted him walking across a bridge on the way into the space. This is the war cry coming up. So that's the informal side of the building, I guess, the place for unstructured learning and socialisation. The other side of the building, which faces out to the boys' grammar playing fields and also the inner city bypass, is entirely different. So this is a foundation building, and what we're interested in is the way in which, as the foundation building, it takes an otherwise rectilinear building and through a fairly modest number of manipulations turns into a very gentle kind of a building. And so we're interested in how we might be able to take straight stick technology and end up with a curvilinear outcome. And not only that, but because we're dealing with an oval and an inner city bypass, an 80 kilometre an hour zone, working with the context of movement, not a physical context, but a context, so it's like a, there's many, many different contexts we try and work with, but I think it's interesting sometimes to move away from physical contexts into other contexts like movement. And so hence this idea of an interference pattern, which was built up between a sunshade to shelter the building from the western sun and the facade itself. So these are tests that we were doing of overlays using acetate to figure out the right pattern that would have a correlation to the sort of geometries of the main building. And so it's kind of a motile effect, so that the viewer in motion creates this sort of pulsating effect on the facade. We were fortunate that we were able to actually model this at 1:9 at a gallery in New South Wales, UTS Gallery, and we had a reasonable idea as to how it was going to work, but still there was a fair bit of nervousness as to how it was going to pan out 1:1. So it's quite a simple piece of technology, actually, and this is the reality of it. A skin of painted fibrous cement, black and white stripes with downpipes and condensing pipes and all manner of things on the right of screen, on the left of screen, the actual sun shading device. And so the black and white stripes are exactly vertical, but the sun shading slats are laid at the most gentle sort of basket weave pattern across the face. So when you look at it from square on, your eye is unable to differentiate between the front layer and the back layer, and then as you run around on the oval or drive your car at 80 kilometres an hour, the facade appears to pulsate. One of the other things we're interested in is multiple interpretations. So after the facade, after the building went up, we had all manner of questions about what's the facade about? Is it something to do with pop art? Is it something to do with fashion design? Where are the motors hidden? Is it solar powered? We had a huge number of questions, but in truth, no one will ever really understand the connection between this and the main building, but I think that's something to be encouraged, not ending up with a finite kind of reading of architectural outcome. Those of you who know your Australian political history might recognise this as Bark Alden in central western Queensland, and the tree on the right of the screen has become known as the Tree of Knowledge, and it's said to be the birthplace of the Australian Labor Party. It's where, in the late 1800s, workers got together and complained about the conditions that their employers were placing upon them. So they met under the tree in the shade of the tree and reacted in many ways. And so that's how it's known to be the birthplace of the Australian Labor Party, as well as other things that went on there. And you can see it on the right of screen. This is an image from probably the 1980s, 1990s, but then someone poisoned the tree using concentrated and huge quantities of Roundup and actually killed the tree. And by that stage, the tree was on the National Heritage Register as a place of political and cultural significance. So the poisoning of the tree was a really, really big deal. And so there was a conservation management plan written, and it said that the tree should be pulled up, taken by the CSIRO, and taken to Brisbane. It's like a pig on a spit, and dipped in a chemical cocktail to preserve it from fungal and UV attack, and then repositioned. And then it also said that a covering, a canopy, needed to be erected to further protect the tree from further decay and so on. So we were actually given the commission to do the canopy part, and the conservation management plan said that the canopy needed to somehow contribute to the qualities that might have once existed beneath the canopy of this tree. So one of the things we were interested in is the kind of idea of mourning the loss of this significant tree, and maybe that we could think of what we were going to build as a kind of veil to this, the ghost of a tree. This was to sit in the main street of Bark Alden, and so we imagined this thing as a ghostly impression of the tree forming this canopy. This concept came up that the stump of the tree on the left, the canopy of the tree in its heyday, and then on the right, the way we might be able to realise this through dangling a series of 1.8 metre long recycled telegraph pole sticks down to the extent of the original canopy. So we digitized, we traced the predominant canopies and then digitized them and ended up with a kind of a reasonable approximation of the extent of the canopy when the tree was healthy. In the end, the concept evolved beyond the veil idea into an idea that, into this idea of the exterior of the building feeling kind of like a sarcophagus to a dead object. But then once you move inside the sarcophagus, you realise the kind of life within it. And this is a drawing that was never shown to anyone. It was for our own sake. This is 60 cross sections through the project, starting with an elevation at the top left and working your way through to the centre of the structure and back out the other side. It's almost like a medical diagnostic tool, working your way from death through various stages of life and back to death. But the way this was actually conveyed to industry and to others was through this much simpler drawing of 3,600 sticks, 60 by 60 grid, with a spot level on the height of each stick to describe the kind of canopy extent. So in the main street, the canopy of the tree is vaguely and very vaguely evident, but then moving to within the space, the canopy becomes apparent. These sticks are 1.8 long, as I said, and they're very, very heavy, and they hang on steel rods. And the roof of the structure is made of translucent polycarbonate. And so what happens is that as the breeze blows, these sticks were designed to move around very gently. Let's see if this... And as the... As the sticks move around, the light on the ground, the dappled light on the ground, moves much like as though you were standing under the tree with some gentle breeze moving through. The quality of the ground plane was something we very much would hold a great deal of importance. This next project is quite a strange little one, actually. You might have been to this one, I think, yes, and wrote a piece about it. This is a project we did for a boys' school in Brisbane called Nudgee College. And this is a very odd multi-function hall. And our commission was to turn this into the drama department's home. And one of the first things we observed was the kind of bizarre similarity between this buttressed kind of heavy-duty building and some of the sort of Mesoamerican architecture. And we imagined that this sort of... really, really hardcore exterior might hold a mysterious and wonderful interior, and so that if we could reinvent the interior, it might enable a kind of fantastic rereading of the outside as well. It also reminded us a bit of the idea of a thunder egg. I don't know if you have thunder eggs down this way, but these wonderful rocks that have this crusty exterior that hold this wonderful surprise on the inside. And I guess without the inside, the outside's a bit worthless. And so what we were going to try to do in this project was reinvent the interior as a theatrical interpretation of the exterior, to make sense of the building as a complete thing. But this is how the interior was as we found it. Certainly had none of the magic of a thunder egg. And so we started working through certain ideas. And this is an image from the Capitol Theatre in Melbourne, the Walter Burley Griffin project. And we were interested in the sort of typology of theatres and especially the sort of foyer spaces. And also, as I said earlier, interested in how we might be able to take some of the formal language of the exterior of the building and work with it through the interiors to make sense of this as a total architectural outcome. So you can see the little keystone, they're almost like little mini buttresses that we found in this amazing little catalogue. And we realised that if we deployed these keystones by their thousand, we could end up with this reference to the exterior of the building as well as this sort of rich interior. Then in terms of the auditorium itself, again, Griffin's Capitol Theatre, this idea that when you go into the theatre, you sort of end up in this otherworldly experience. We're interested in that as an idea as well, and how we might be able to take the external formal language of the project and bring it in. So you can see the buttresses on the right and left side of the building, and those lines arrayed parallel all the way through the building, and the horizontal datum arrayed upwards as well, creating this sort of triangulated facade. We had this small amount of spare space, about that much, not wide enough to fit an extra row of seats, but nevertheless a depth that we could use it in terms of interesting facade. So what we are interested in here is a way of generating facade that might engage these teenage adolescent boys in the theatre. So some sort of optical and spatial effect that they could then manipulate the lighting, and would also act as an acoustical kind of fracturing facade. So on the left of the screen, what you're seeing is when you look square onto the facade, you see these black laminate triangles in the foreground, and then the triangle facing down is a perforated plywood panel in the background. And then the perpendicular surface, so in this surface here, is actually mirrored. So this is akin to a kaleidoscope. So that green post-it note is real, and these ones are reflected through the optics of these two mirrors. Similarly, you can see, looking square on, that's an orange bar, and it begins to become multiplied throughout this kaleidoscopic facade. So we did a series of tests just to see what potential this might have. This is a 1:1 prototype that we made. And the end result is actually a series of diamonds. So these are diamonds of white phosphorescent laminate, and each of them has a pinprick of fiber optic light. So when you walk into the space, the lights can be down quite low, and these fiber optics actually energise this piece of white phosphorescent laminate. And then when you look at this on the diagonal, the kaleidoscopy effect multiplies these diamonds and makes sort of pinwheels of various star shapes, a bit like the Griffin Theatre at Starry Night Sky. So when you walk into the theatre and take your seat, the idea was that in your peripheral vision you would see this fantastic starry night sky, and then as the house lights fade and the stage lights come up, it continues to glow very subtly in your peripheral vision. So this is the facade looking square on upon entry, and then on stage looking back up. So as I was saying, only one of those diamonds is real, the rest are multiplied in the mirrors. There's so many permutations and combinations of lighting here for the students to get the teeth into. And this is a rugby mad school, and they had some issues in terms of drama take up in that kind of environment. So what we're trying to do is make a really kind of tangible way into stage and theatre management and that kind of thing. So that's the phosphorescent laminate, just under its own glow. This is a really fast-track project that we got involved in to put a bridge across a really busy street in Brisbane, spanning from Fairfield Station across Yeerong Police Station across Fairfield Road to the Pat Rafter Tennis Arena. And when we came onto the project, this structure here had already been designed, and the main roads department had tried to get this through the approvals process, but they hit a snag when they went to this entity called the Board for Urban Places, which is a bit of a it's kind of an entity that was set up to capture important projects and make sure they have an adequate amount of architectural thought applied to them. And when this particular proposal reached the Board for Urban Places, they said, no, not good enough. We think you need to actually make this more suitable to its this burgeoning sort of tennis-centric community. So we ended up being commissioned to try to tennis the bridge up a bit, whatever that might mean. And we asked if we'd take on the challenge, and it was a really, really fast-track kind of process. So we were having to turn up to design presentations every few days with schemes. So one of the first things that occurred was the proportion of this was very similar to a tennis net, and the sort of interest in the structure of tennis nets and how we might be able to then take the structure of nets and a little bit like the girl's grammar moire interference pattern, work with varying kind of techniques to end up with apparent distortion and a thing that might actually appear to be moving as you drive underneath it along Fairfield Road. We're also a little bit obsessed with, for a while, with high-vis fairy balls and whether we could, again, using similar moiré techniques and so on, end up with something where when you drive along Fairfield Road, these hazy yellow things might appear to be moving on the bridge. I don't know if you've ever seen those books called Kick and Gallop, where when you open the page, it appears as though a dog is running or a ball is bouncing. We were wondering whether or not we could pull off some kind of thing where, as your eye level descends, travelling down Fairfield Road, it appears as though a ball is actually sort of like bouncing across the bridge. The whole time we're doing this, it all felt a bit gimmicky and a bit inappropriate in many ways. So what we actually... in the background, we actually had this realisation that the structure that had already been proposed, and we were begged and pleaded with to retain the structure that had already been designed. We realised that the structure of the bridge was exactly the same as the array on a Dunlop volley. And one of the things that's really nice about that is the sort of flattening of the appeal of this, because this bridge is not only going to be used on match days, but it was also for the local area to access the train every other day of the week. And so whilst Dunlop volleys were the professional tennis player's shoe of choice back in the 1960s, 70s, Yvonne Guillaume, Ken Rosewall, they're now sort of much more broadly popular. You know, every indie kid, weekend fisherman, roofing contractor's owns a pair of Dunlop volleys. So we settled on that as the idea and then went to work on how to build it. And we've never worked in fiberglass before, but we wanted something that was going to end up having this wonderful kind of rubbery effect. We're also really under the pump in terms of how to build it. It had to be built in a shop for the most part, but then the bridge proper had to be built beside the road about a kilometre down from where it was going to be erected. And everything about this was geared to enable this to arrive on the back of a truck and be positioned with about a 4 or 5 hour road closure to enable the road to be reopened the following morning. So it was a fairly tense evening when a truck arrived with this big bridge on the back of it, and literally happen just like that. And the next morning, hey presto, open for business. The other thing that we really took a lot of delight in is the unsung hero, you know, the idea of the underdog, this fantastic champion of Australia, quite an invention in its day, actually, and the way that this sort of token of patriotism might be able to be even further explored. And so the interior of this bridge is, pays homage to the sort of finer detailing of the Dunlop Volley. I think we've only got a couple of projects to go here. This is a project we did for the University of Queensland, for the swimming pool in the, I can't remember what year it was, but you might remember the Brisbane floods. So the Brisbane, Queensland University swimming pool got completely flooded, and whilst the pool's all right, all the facilities around the pool were completely ruined. So we were commissioned to rebuild all of those elements. And we, in thinking about it, there was something really kind of wonderful about everything to do with municipal pools, you know, the colour of the water, the sounds of recreation, the kind of reflectance of light, and so on. We were thinking that often this is only really made apparent from within the pool, and how wonderful it would be if those sort of sights and sounds and light qualities could be made apparent into the public realm beyond the swimming pool. We're also really interested in how we might make reference to the Brisbane flood. So you can see the brown column giving way to white. That's the datum of the floods. And the ceiling, this simple idea of fibrous cement painted in matte white with these small amounts of gloss white paint. And as you move your way further outside the pool, out in the public realm, the ceiling used as kind of like this diaphragm to reflect sound, as well as reflect the blue of the water. Also, this typology in our reasonably benign climate, where all of the change rooms are contained within those brick walls and ventilate upward beneath that simple white canopy. This is a very kind of effective and inexpensive idea as to how a swimming pool kind of public realm might operate. This is a project we has only just completed, so these photos are a bit dodgy. This is a project we did for the Abused Children's Trust, and this is on the James Cook University campus. And Townsville is in the dry tropics, and nearly the entire place all year round is brown, except for this one little, this was our site that was given to the Abused Children's Trust, which had this really unusual lushness and microclimate. And so the building that we were asked to design was a number of things. It was to be the administration, and it was also to have a small amount of childcare. But most importantly, it was to include a suite of therapy rooms. And as you can imagine, this particular organisation is dealing with some really sensitive issues, and some of the kids that they get in are quite damaged. And so it's quite difficult. One of the pieces of research we did was the benefit of landscape to therapy. So this idea arose that this central clearing within the site is absolutely the sweet spot, and that we would use that to place this most special part of the program, to place the therapy rooms within this clearing in the landscape. The plan of the project is almost kind of self-evident, but this is the administration component of the building. This is the childcare. It's almost like a tiny kindergarten. And these are the therapy rooms. And the extent of the building is actually determined by an arborist with us in terms of the setback from each of these tree trunks, so as to not affect the health of the tree. For the most part, these are paper barks, and for the most part, these are eucalypts. And so it's designed so that each of these therapy spaces would look out to a tree or out into a useful courtyard space. Some of the other things we're really interested in is on the site there are some foundation buildings done by Jim Gurrell. He's, for those of you who don't know much about Brisbane, Jim was one of our celebrated architects from the 1960s, 70s, 80s. And this project in particular, I thought was a wonderful exemplar project for ours, which is an unmistakably or unashamedly public building with some really tough materials, but tough materials deployed in a really gentle kind of a way. And what we're after is public building sensibility and a tough building, but one that had this gentility about it. And the sort of combination of grey block and precast concrete, I think, is this lovely kind of softness that comes about from it. Some more of Jim's work on the site, but this has got a much more monumental scale, so we're more interested in the former. We're also quite interested in children's play and the architecture of children's play and the way that that kind of translates into a more sort of serious architectural possibility. And also this kind of the junction between this high-end architecture, Adolf Loos kind of high-end round plan, sort of spatial interconnectivity mashed up with kind of IKEA, the idea of IKEA sort of children's furniture, which has a much simpler connotation. This is the project, and as I said, it's just literally been landscaped, hot off the press in a way, and so it's looking a bit raw, but nevertheless I thought it was worth showing. So one of the things we wanted to do was use a very small number of building elements and make it very clear as to how these elements were put together. So it's a very kind of like tangible, so it's kind of a building. Every single block in the building is a bullnose block, so we developed this kind of coursing pattern such that all of the corners half of the perpends have this gentility about them, and all of the lintels are made of precast concrete. So as you work your way up through and into the entrance space, this sort of some of the sensibilities I was referring to earlier come into play. This is the administration, which is probably the most ordinary part, but then when you get up to the top of the administration, you start to understand how this building that wraps itself around these trees can work. So this is moving from administration out into this therapy building and into the centre space, which has this scalloped oculus for this landscape, this newly planted landscape of our own to grow up and through. So when you stand in that central space, when the doors are all open, you have this strong sense of the clearing that I was referring to earlier, standing in the centre of the clearing, looking up to the top of the canopy and out into the ground plane. As the landscape grows, the idea is that these native grasses will grow up and make these therapy rooms quite a bit more private. This is out the back to the kindergarten kind of space, which is mostly to do with outdoor play, and then being able to kind of retreat back into this interior. How are we going for time, Kathy? Should I?
10 minutes.
Do you want me to just? I'll show you one project that's under construction, and then we can pause for question time. So this is a project, the creative learning centre that I showed you earlier with the Western sunscreen is here. We've got a project under construction just here, and I was just going to show you the scheme for it, which is it's basically a library. And what we really wanted to do was fit a building in between that edge of that building and this fantastic fig tree. And without any demolition, that was our brief to ourselves, zero demolition, keep the tree, I have a daughter who attends this school, and on the first day of Year 8, they read this book called Imagine a Day, and this is the last page of the book. And I think what's really nice about this image is the way that bookshelves become balconies, and books become doorways to other worlds, and small things become big things, and sort of the idea of possibilities through knowledge. And we kind of developed this thinking about a library, that imagine if we could build a building that might be able to excite the search for knowledge somehow, so students who enter the building might really love the thrill of the hunt to walk into a building and be able to worm their way around through this sort of vertical labyrinth to find whatever it is that they're after. We also had this idea about this wonderful fig tree, that the building might be able to be thought of as some kind of frame to this tree, and so as you move up and down within the building, there's a sense of moving about the canopy of this tree. As we kept working on the project, we sort of realised that we had this, we had to accommodate a distribution of classrooms as well as the library program, and we broke it up into 25 modules, five up, five stories high, five modules long, and we realised we had a small amount of redundancy, and that coupled with the fact that if you have anything more than a two-storey atrium, you need to put fire sprinklers into a building, and we particularly wanted to avoid sprinklers in this library building, so hence this sort of matrix of interconnected two-storey spaces, but then as you see it as a complete kind of cross-section, the distribution of classrooms and library is all kind of intermingled, so there's no distinction between learning in a classroom, learning in a library, it's thought of as one kind of research space. So this is the actual outcome, and you can see that the way that instead of books occupying space, books line walls, and so each of these spaces is able to be used as a classroom or as a library module. So if you think about a five floor plated building, and then with less than 7% floor loss, you end up completely skewing the kind of perception of an otherwise prosaic building. So this is the, just to very quickly show you the floor plates. You can see the five modules of the building, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And as you work your way up through the building, the void slips around depending on what floor you're on to end up with the slippage in this interconnected two-storey space outcome. The typical module itself has books lining walls, this sweeping stair that enables students to kind of come up and then be returned to that side. There's an efficient side through here, so you can walk the full length of the building on that side, but this side, if you were to walk through that doorway, you end up often arriving here where you're unable to walk any further, so you're forced to kind of come back around, hence this sort of poetic sort of labyrinth-like quality. We're quite interested to allude to something going on inside the building, but not completely give the game away from the outside. So what we're really aiming for here is that the tree would be reflected in this facade, but also you'd be able to see through and see students sort of moving up and through this space. And from the other side, this tree's probably got another 100 years to live, according to our arborist. That, coupled with the overhang on the building, shades nearly all of the facade, but not quite all of it. And these fins shade the exact amount of sun that remains. So it sort of traces the shadow of the sun path, in a sense. These are just the typical two-storey bays. So I guess what we're going back to what I said earlier, this was trying to take the specificity of a couple of forces at play here, the tree, the pedagogy of trying to excite a search for knowledge, as well as this sort of BCA requirement of sticking to two-storey volumes, and ultimately end up with this place that students might walk in on the ground floor and really, if they need a book on the fourth floor down the other end of the building, really thoroughly enjoy going to find. And I always think that the search for knowledge or even a search for a design idea. It's actually all the stuff around it that's more interesting than the thing you thought you were looking for in the first place. And sometimes the things you find along the way are better than what you thought you were going to find in any case. I'll probably leave it there and open up for questions.